Hello, hello. Good afternoon to one and all. How's everybody doing out there? You all okay? Can you hear us all right? No, you cannot hear us? How's that better? Testing, 1, 2. How's that better? Okay, good. Project, we have to project. My name is Owsley Brown, and I want to welcome you all to today's afternoon session of the 2013 Festival of Faiths. You know the title, Sacred Silence, Pathway to Compassion. And we've had a wonderful morning and a great day yesterday and wonderful days ahead of us. So please, if you haven't already, look at your program and know that we'd love to have you for any of our forthcoming events. We're so glad you're here. Without you, we don't have a festival. And rather than go through the long list of thanks, let me just do an abbreviated version by saying none of this would be possible, of course, without incredibly generous support from this community, including you all, who chose to buy tickets. And the names of our sponsors are all prominently featured in the lobby. And please, if you can, hold it in your hearts that we were helped by this great group. But also, of course, the office that has put this all together deserves extra special thanks, led by our fearless leader, executive director, and moderator today, Dr. Kathleen Lyons, along with especially Sarah Reed Harris and Chris Wooten. So if you see them or if you don't know them, just hold their extraordinary work in your hearts as well. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to my co-collaborator, co-programmer, Gray Henry, who will introduce our speaker.
Martin Laird, renowned author and a professor of early Christian studies at Villanova University. Silence is both porous and generous enough to receive both noise and no noise, and forms the ground from which we both see through the illusion and separation from God, and are trained by the ordeals of life rooted in the mystery in whom we live and move and have our being. Martin Laird is an Augustinian friar and a priest and is a professor of early Christian studies. He has lectured and led retreats throughout the United States and Europe. Among his books and articles are Into the Silent Land and A Sunlit Absence, Silence, Awareness, and Contemplation. His writings, lectures, and retreats on the ancient Christian practice of contemplation focus on seeing through the illusion that we are separate from the mystery, which many traditions call God. We welcome Martin.
What we can do.
The silence.
Yes. So we had a little, yes. Now, Martin, would you like to join us for this little section? You're going to come here first. So what we're going to do is, it's a little back stage window you're getting here. We're going to have our moment of silence. We have been trying something for the first time, which is why it's still finding its way into our natural expression as hosts, which is to begin and end all of our sessions with silence. And I'll be the timekeeper in this case, and we have a gong just beneath us, and you want to ring that gong, Gray? We'll just sit quietly for about 3 minutes, and then Father Laird, you'll come on up here to this podium. Great, and then we'll be off to the races. We like to do that in this town. Okay.
Well, I'm very honored and happy to be with you this afternoon. One warning, those who are hard of hearing find me very hard to hear. And so those with hearing aids or whatever, turn them up or off as my lecture proceeds. Sort of the fortune cookie version of my talk regarding sacred silence is that it is not something any of us has to acquire. It is something that is already coursing the depths of our being. And the Christian contemplative journey is not a journey to get something like a degree or a qualification. It's an unfolding of who we are. The longer version of the talk, I'd like to focus on three main topics. One, where does the practice of contemplation, as I call it, I don't use the word centering prayer because that belongs to centering prayer groups. I don't use meditation because that sort of is owned by Lawrence Freeman. And so I simply call it the practice of contemplation, the cultivation of the interior silence gives way to the simplest of facts. As the author of The Cloud of Unknowing put it, God is your being. And if you don't know who you are, you don't know God. So first, I'd like to say something about where the practice of contemplation in the Christian tradition comes from, historically, and then some comments on the wonderful world of distractions and how, as our practice of contemplation deepens, our relationship with distractions changes. And then I would like to speak to some of the challenges that come up. Many people use spirituality to keep at bay what spirituality will try to make you face. And I would like to address, among many possible choices, how it can help us negotiate inner trials such as depression, panic, or anxiety. And then I would turn my attention to this sacred silence, this silence that gives birth to silence itself. And that silence, with a capital S, has no opposite and is generous and porous enough to receive both noise and the absence of noise, both sound waves and the absence of sound waves. the historical origins of the practice of contemplation that can be documented. I'm an historical theologian by training, so we have this fetish about documentation. And as far as written texts go, now you can presume things were passed on by oral tradition, but really the 4th century, the rise of contemplative spirituality in the Egyptian desert, as well as Syria, Jerusalem, Gaul. But we have the most documentation coming out of Egypt in the writings of the desert fathers and mothers. And the one who has most to say is a man named Evagrius. And according to this, the desert tradition, it's called that because it takes its root in the Egyptian desert, huh? They believed that the practice of contemplation comes from Jesus himself. Not taught in the Transfiguration on the Mount, or the Sermon on the Mount, or the multiplication of loaves and fishes, not in the healing of the man born blind, or the casting out of demons. They saw the practice of contemplation emerge from Jesus' own temptation in the desert that immediately follows his baptism. The fullest account of this is in Matthew 4, the first 11 verses. And normally we hear this read out in church every certain number of cycles, and sometimes in daily mass. But growing up, I had the impression that Jesus was in the desert and in conversation with Satan. It sounds like that. And this is precisely what the desert contemplatives saw was not happening. And there you have, and you can simply turn to Matthew 1-11 and read that Jesus is not engaging in conversation with the Satan who is putting thoughts into his head about reputation, about power, about achievement. Instead of getting caught up in conversation, interior conversation, Jesus quoted scripture, lines of scripture, lines from Deuteronomy, of all things. And Evagrius says this inner dialogue with the Satan is precisely what Jesus refrained from doing. Instead of engaging in direct dialogue with Satan, Jesus recited lines from scripture. And so Evagrius, speaking for a host of desert contemplatives, said in the prologue, part 5 of a book of his called the Antirrheticus, commonly translated today as Talking Back. There's a new translation out of it. But he says in the prologue, he says, Jesus passed on what he did when tempted by Satan. Very interesting phenomenon. My pages are out of numerical order. there we go, for the time being. And what Jesus passed on was, in the moment of struggle, when the demons attack, and they attack through afflictive thoughts, when the demons attack us, we must answer them with a verse from Holy Scripture. Listening attentively to the account of Jesus' temptation in the desert, Evagrius and others like him observed that Jesus thereby avoided getting caught up in any sort of inner chatter, inner monologue. Instead, Jesus quoted lines of Scripture. Now, for some reason or another, quoting lines of Deuteronomy didn't catch on, thank God. In order to break the cycle of inner chatter. And the thoughts are the only way, is the only weapon of the demons. A desert, fourth century desert psychology expresses itself in the language of demons and their ability subtly to use thoughts. And Evagrius says famously in the Practicos, one of his seminal works, eight types, but which came down into history as the seven deadly sins. But in other works, on thoughts, for example, he adds others to these eight, like shame, like fear. And the strategy of the demons is to get your attention riveted to some sort of inner commentary. And if successful, we can live our entire lives, decades of it, with the attention riveted to an inner world of talking, 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 nonstop. And if not talking, then texting, 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 nonstop, then tweeting, 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 tweeting. Early contemplatives soon realized that the name Jesus also casts out demons. That is, and their bombardment with thoughts. And also implies the presence of the Holy Spirit. So early on, this became contemplative practice had a Trinitarian grounding to it. I don't want to get off on that, but stay with the practical. And uniting the name Jesus with one's breath became one of the earliest forms of Christian contemplative practice. Saint John Climacus provides some of the most succinct and helpful instruction of all. He says, let the remembrance of Jesus, he doesn't mean a discursive remembrance of who Jesus was, but calling to mind the name of Jesus as a, to today we would call a prayer word, what in the ancient Latin tradition was called a versiculum. United with the breath, St. John Climacus says, and then you will know the meaning of stillness. The practice of contemplation in the Christian tradition tends to emphasize the cultivation of concentration through the use of a short phrase or prayer word, often inspired by scripture, but not necessarily. But this is not the only way to dispose ourselves to the gift of contemplation. There's a practice of contemplation developed or associated especially with the Benedictine family, and also, but one of the best expositions of this is from a Carthusian, not a member of the Benedictine family. His name is Gigo II. How do you like that for a name? Huh? I'm sure nobody belongs to a parish called St. Gigo's. But he explains in The Ladder of Monks something he inherited as a way of reading and resting in scripture in such a way that we ultimately are drawn into the silence of the text. See, the ancient world had a different notion of what a text was, what a sacred text was. You actually couldn't photocopy it. It was a repository of presence, just like a tabernacle is a repository of presence that transcends the letters of scripture. And through different types of reading, reading along the storyline till something captures your attention, and then you meditate on it, drawing out its practical moral meaning for your life, and then ruminating on it, like a cow chewing its cud, until finally the silence of the text opens and there one rests. I know one monk who spent, this was his way of prayer. He started with John's prologue 20 years ago. And he hasn't got beyond it. He's found something he found so rich in the silence of the text, drawing him into communion. John of the Cross apparently didn't use any sort of concentrative technique. He used what easily would be called today mindfulness. And he says, he simply says this, this was his practice, preserve a loving awareness of God with no desire to feel or understand any particular thing concerning God. Just simple being. Simple being is awareness before it becomes awareness of something. The mind very quickly moves from awareness into an object of awareness. I'm aware of someone texting. I'm aware of the fact I just went through a red light. But the ground of awareness, the awaring itself, this led John of the Cross to the stunning insight that God is your center. The center of who we are is more than we ourselves. If your self-knowledge hasn't burrowed in to the ineffable mystery that is what we term God, then we don't know ourselves fully as creatures, have not come to full flourishing. Of which Paul says in Colossians 3, our lives, he wouldn't have known the word self as a separate psychological entity, which is illusory anyway. He simply says your life is hidden. Yourself, to grossly translate, is hidden. Christ and God. This is a luminous and solid seat, but most find, at least early on, the use of some sort of anchor, like the breath, or a prayer word, or sacred word, or Christianity has absorbed the term mantra. You're not, you know, being heretical or something like that necessarily. Although many people will call you heretical, and that's usually to be taken as a compliment, I've discovered. simply because they don't know themselves nor the tradition. Evagrius says, let us sit still and keep our attention fixed within. St. Augustine says in his letter to Proba, keep the attention within. Simone Weil, the Jewish philosopher who enjoyed a deep experience of Jesus while visiting the Benedictine Abbey of Salem. She says this, prayer consists of attention, and the quality of the attention counts for much in the quality of the prayer, and the protection, the practice of contemplation begins with attention, with our attention and our bodies. Attending to the breath, and there's a good 1,000 years testimony to this. I wrote a potted history of this in Into the Silent Land, but a much longer version of this in an article later. But it is part of the Christian package. And for a very human reason. Have you ever tried to thread a needle while hyperventilating? Or thread a needle while you're yelling at your husband to take out the garbage? The breath automatically lengthens and slows down. So we're just using the wisdom of the body to facilitate stilling of the mind. The early contemplatives knew about the importance of a solid, erect posture. St. Gregory of Sinai recommends sitting on a bench around 9 inches high. Today we call them prayer benches. They're, you know, we sit on our calves and sit back on it with the back straight but not rigid. You know, it's not military alertness. But not the student stoop. But the point is that the body's physical stability and stillness facilitates interior silencing, cultivating a still mind. These prayer benches are easily Googleable. They do run you about $60 or $90. Regularly, Christians use what we saw this morning, a prayer cushion on a Buddhist tradition, or at least the Zen Buddhist tradition, called a zafu and a zabaton. I don't know what the Tibetans call it. Those are also easily Googleable, and you can use your credit card or PayPal or anything you like. But the point, it is a part of, this isn't just sort of like prayer equipment. It facilitates sitting over longish periods of time so that the body's stillness can help with the problem of the wandering, roving mind that flits from topic to topic to topic to topic to argument to something that's happened 25 years ago. I won't have time to tell you the fascinating story about my cranberry aunt, but that would be a different talk. And they would open up the trap door afraid underneath this podium, because it was fascinating. So anyway, I won't tease you. But the practice of contemplation is quite simple. The goal is never not to have thoughts. The goal, the practice is, whenever you become aware that your attention has been stolen, you bring it back to your practice. Say it is simple awareness of your breath, or your breath united with a prayer word, or simple sitting in awareness. The practice is not trying not to be distracted. Thoughts will come from the four corners of the earth, if you try that. Imagine everybody right now, I say, don't think of the Eiffel Tower. St. Teresa of Avila put it centuries ago, by trying not to think, we hopelessly stimulate the imagination. And the harder you try not to think of anything, the more aroused your mind will become, and you will think even more. Nor do we push away thoughts in an attempt to generate some sort of dull blankness. Instead, we simply bring the attention home. And whenever we find their attention has been stolen, we bring the attention back It's always the default settings are quite simple. Bring the attention home. Now, be careful for the thoughts that will attach to recognizing you've been distracted. We say to ourselves, oh my gosh, I was distracted. Well, you've just added a thought onto another thought. Oh my goodness, I can't have those thoughts. Well, we've added thought upon thought upon thought. And remain ever removed from the simplicity of simply returning the attention to our practice. This will create over many seasons what Christianity calls a habitus, a habit, which is in the spiritual discipline sense of that word, an interior momentum that gradually excavates the present moment, revealing over time the stillness that is within us all already. In early seasons of practice, it's typical that our experience of abiding in the immersion, or of being immersed in the silence of God, that there be little abiding sense of this. Instead, we try to be silent, and we find that there is anything but silence within. And very often we try to insulate ourselves from meeting this absolutely fundamentally crucial launching of the contemplative ship by never being in a place where there is not some external noise to distract you from this. Can't even get into an elevator without hearing music, and then shopping malls, my goodness gracious, I haven't been to one in years because they're just deafening. The culture of distraction and the culture of, and the commodity culture of possessing things work together to keep us riveted to inner chatter. And this is all in the language of fourth century psychology, this is all the demons are interested in, is keeping your attention riveted to these inner videos, this inner chatter. And their work is done because they keep you ignorant then of your center, which is the doctor of the church, John of the Cross says, is God. The cloud of, author of the cloud of the knowing says, is your being, but you're not God's being. Whatever makes you, you is God, but you don't make God, God. But because of the nearly complete identification with the thinking mind, especially the inner chatter, we have a strong tendency to move through life reactively. One of the great splits, the great manifestations of cultural, well, religious schizophrenia is to identify is to say the opposite of the contemplative life is the active life. The opposite of the contemplative life is this reactive life, constantly reacting to what's going on in our heads. It's something like entering a phone booth. I can hardly use the word phone booth with my undergraduate students because they've heard of them, but they've never actually been in one. But they know what you mean. Like they know what you mean if you say dial a phone. They remember that because their grandmothers might still have one. But anyway, it's something like being in a the experience of ourselves as though we were in a phone booth with a bee in it. We're going to be very reactive to that bee. Watching where it is at every moment, very distracted and reactive to it. At some point in our practice of contemplation, our experience of interior silence will expand. And we step out of that phone booth that we previously thought was our identity. And then we could call it something like an INFP or an S on the Enneagram or an 8 on the Richter scale. But you step out of the phone booth. And then your experience of the bees of distraction are quite different. And this marks a critical threshold of allowing the expanseless expanse to move into awareness. Then these bees of distraction, well, they're simply bees. They're doing what bees do. Pollinating, going from clover to bee balm to echinacea to rudbeckia, and they're no particular threat. This is what happens. Our relationship with distraction changes as our interior silence deepens or begins to expand. Two ways of saying the same thing. And then we're not so distracted by the fact that there are distractions. We have a changed relationship with distractions. One from the threat of the bee in the phone booth to walking in an open field. Bees are no threat, and we see them as the vital role they play in the Earth's ecology. The point is, with deepening or further unfolding of our contemplative practice, our relationship with distractions changes. Distractions are present, but our relationship with them has changed. A third sort of season of how the deepening of our practice and the expansion of interior silence changes our relationship with distractions. From bee in the phone booth, highly reactive, to bees in the field doing what bees are meant to do. Bees aren't really meant to be in phone booths anyway. They never have change on them. The Russian monk, Theophan, the recluse, he liked to have been a recluse, but he was constantly visited by people who sought his wisdom. And his prayer word, he's Russian, and they are the sort of default settings of Russian contemplative practice is the Jesus prayer, as well as the Greek Orthodox, but it has come into the West as well. But it's not determinative, it's how it serves the stilling of the wandering, roving mind. Anyway, the Russian monk Theophan says, delve deeply into the Jesus prayer. He doesn't mean repeat it as a mantra over and over and over and over and over again. We've done that. What he's speaking of is that at a certain point, beyond our control, when everything is ripe and ready, our practice, whatever we use to still the mind, the breath united with a prayer word, or just sitting in loving awareness, something will happen. It will open up. And we can delve deeply into it. Like pushing off the sides of a pool. And this is the natural development of the dynamism of a contemplative discipline. It takes on, as it were, a dimensionality. There is something to gaze into that is untouched by distraction. Distractions may be floating around, like weather on a mountain. But the mountain knows it's not the weather. We tend, until our practice is putting down roots, we tend to think we're the weather. When we're the mountain on which weather occurs. And weather's always occurring. What would a mountain be without weather happening on it? But we're not the weather. And this clears, and this is a great liberation and a deeper manifestation of our identity that remains hidden with Christ in God. And this identity is of no interest to the IRS. What I'm talking about won't show up on a CCTV camera. It's a transformation of awareness, but one that is the way awareness was meant to be, the way a tulip. When I say the word tulip, you think of the flower. I bring a tulip bulb into my classroom and I say, what's this? And nobody has any idea on earth what on earth it is. They say it's some sort of retarded onion. I am just surprised that undergraduates these days know what an onion is. They just, see that it's chopped up in their salad so that they can continue to weigh 75 pounds. And then I bring out of a bag a tulip blossom. And then I hold up the bulb. And they stare at me like I have two heads. Then someone will say, oh, well, that's a tulip bulb, and this tulip is hidden in the bulb and trying to emerge. And that's what these depths are doing. Doing what created to do. Unfold our identity in God. That is the full blossoming of a creature. And our relationship with distractions will change. Saint Isaac the Syrian says, and this is where I drew the title of the talk, after a time, a certain sweetness is born in the heart out of our practice. Let us give ourselves over to the practice of silence, and then from out of this silence, something is born that leads to silence itself. This silence itself is a capital S. As much as a tangle our practice may seem, it will begin to untangle. And our relationship changes with these distractions, because there is a subtle process of transfer of identity. No longer do we identify our sense of who we are from the wandering, roving, reacting, be in the phone booth mind. Or derive our sense of who we are by trying to guess, deriving it by trying to guess what other people think of us. And what previous seasons of our practice have done, as they have changed, they become, at this season, see-through. See-through as chicken wire, at most. Most of them are not even there in the way we previously thought they were there. What happens at this stage of practice? Mostly nothing. But it is a nothing brimming with fullness and inner freedom. Our search for God, who has sought and found us from all eternity, is shown to be nothing but this deep listening. So as our practice of contemplation deepens, our relationship with distractions deepen from something that seemed solid as a brick wall to something with respect to which we feel a certain insulation, as it were, due to the expansion of inner silence and the withdrawal of our identity from all the world of inner chatter, where we know also of how everybody else ought to believe and act and vote. For all of our spiritual striving and attempts to enter this path of interior silence, the practice of contemplation can no more deliver the gift of contemplation. Remember, we're only practicing. The practice itself simply disposes us to the gift of contemplation, what Christians call grace. So it can no more deliver the gift of contemplation than the most skillful sailor can make the wind blow. But without sailing skills, the sailor's voyage would be perilous. The contemplative, whose skills are trained by the storms and trials of this path, discovers the joy that while we can never grasp God, God nevertheless does nothing but graciously give, ground us, embrace us. Such is the nature of the divine simplicity. When we're in the phone booth with the bee, sometimes the bee stings us. That is to say, there are ordeals that are absolutely fundamental to the strengthening and deepening of our practice. Can you imagine a pianist who only learned to play chopsticks after the young pianist or the beginning pianist has mastered chopsticks and maybe learned Heart and Soul, if remember that little ditty, a skilled teacher will present a more challenging score and more challenging moves, say an arpeggio. And at first this is awkward. But with time and practice, quantity of practice, quantity will become quality, and suddenly this becomes second nature. And next thing you know, the young pianist has graduated to the Moonlight Sonata, or Eine kleine Nachtmusik. And so in the spiritual life, ordeals are built into the process. You cannot become a contemplative without these trials. You cannot become a monk, that is to say one person, instead of the many fragments and voices of persons we think we are, without these trials. I'd like to speak about two trials, or three. They kind of go together in many people's experience, not everybody's, but hopefully whatever your trials are that come up, the trials of self-knowledge, the trial that you're not the spiritual Hercules you thought you were. Or you realize you're not going to be as holy as you thought you were. But other trials, such as depression, panic and anxiety, these too if met in the right way, deepen our practice. That presents a case study featuring a person named Josh. His name isn't Josh. Obviously, I've changed names and other things to protect identity. But the poor soul, it hurt even to wake up in the morning. Physically, Josh looked fine, but emotionally, he was black and blue. The sleepless hours in bed at night were an ordeal. For the terrors of the night, Psalm 90 puts it, prevented the soft, forgetful release into sleep. And when morning came, finally, it took him 20 to 30 minutes to get off the edge of the bed. Shaving could take another half hour. He would get sort of hypnotized in the mirror. And it took several years for depression's clamp to tighten its grip enough to make Josh want to see his doctor. And the doctor recommended medication. And then he asked Josh, have you ever thought of meditation? And the question threw him. And the doctor added, you know, there's only just one letter difference between meditation and medication. But it threw Josh because years ago, Josh had indeed a very well-established practice of silent prayer, but it fell by the wayside. He began praying a contemplative practice after he came across a simple book that many people have come across, The Way of a Pilgrim. And it moved him deeply, the way this tale of a Russian pilgrim's discovery of the Jesus Prayer as a way of fulfilling Scripture's invitation in 1 Thessalonians, pray always. He used to sit completely still and pray the Jesus Prayer for a half hour, first thing in the morning, as well as when he cycled to and from work. But after several months, his initial enthusiasm went flat. Boredom set in. Now that's another important transition that I won't have time to go into today. But listlessness, when what previously attracted us, the lights go out, and we're met with boredom. And so he stopped praying because it's too boring. So he flipped around the TV channels with the television remote. Meanwhile, his contemplative practice fell down somewhere behind the sofa and remained there for years. So Josh took his doctor's advice and returned to his former practice of silent prayer in the mornings, as well as when cycling to and from work. And this is important too, because it works. It's a contemplative practice that makes use of the body, works itself into the body. When I entered the novitiate of my order, I was a bit precious, and I heard the novice master saying each of us we'd have house jobs, and I said, well, that's fine, I'm happy to help out around the house, but I don't do toilets. and my first house job was, obviously, I read the bulletin board, toilets. But I'd been sitting for some time, and when I have to to depart from the mic a bit, but when I would then kneel down to clean behind the toilets, my body didn't know I was cleaning toilets. My body thought I was praying because I always sat like this. And so my practice started going. And I thought, wow. And so I'd sort of shield my eyes and clean behind the toilets and enjoy a few minutes of prayer. And it works itself into the body. Huh? The body is a great ally and repository of contemplative silence and wisdom. And the medical world is figuring this out now. I'm sure we'll hear about it later in the week. Huh? And you know, people are asking, why don't more doctors prescribe meditation? Well, it's because GlaxoSmithKline and Pfizer can't fit it into a pill. And Josh had an amazing breakthrough, the only breakthrough he had in his life. He awoke in the middle of the night, he says, as I usually do, and I felt some cleansing warmth welling up within me. The name Jesus was a living presence streaming within me. Something inside started being freed up, and I started to weep in this cleansing warmth and compassion. I wept much of the night and awoke in the morning still praying the Jesus prayer. This just was his practice. Doesn't have to be yours, but the dynamics of practice are the same. Huh? They're liberating. And they will dig loose what needs, what blocks, and needs to be dug out or confronted. He went downstairs for breakfast, and his sister had come over, and she said, "What is wrong with you? You look happy." That was the first and last time, he said, anything spiritual happened like that. But I'm more or less faithful to the periods of praying, even if there are no more experiences like this one. There is still something deeply attractive that keeps drawing me back, a sense of being just on the verge of finding life again. Josh's ordeal with depression and anxiety provides a concrete example of how deepening concentration accompanies expanding awareness. Like a pebble dropped in a pond sends out ever-widening rings. This concentrated plop and the expanding rings of awareness are inseparable. Now, it took quite some time for medication and meditation to mop up the kicked over bucket of a decade's despair. It's easier than we think to use spirituality to keep at bay what spirituality will one day make us face, so that we will grow Can you remember? Can you imagine being a member of La Leche by age 50? No, you're weaned. As Paul says, and John of the Cross says, and all the saints and sages, you're weaned onto solid food of life as it is, as it happens to be at any given moment. Have you noticed that about life? Life happens to be the way it is at any given moment. Hang on to that moment and discover that there is a depth dimension to that moment, but it requires a silent mind to stay with the ever-flowing moment and discover that there is a depthless depth. Now, Joshua's depression did not clear up completely in the short or medium long term. And I use that as an example, an important example, that a contemplative discipline helps us live with the way life happens to be. If our brains don't produce enough serotonin or dopamines or norepinephrines or whatever cocktail of chemicals are in our brains that are off balance, often for genetic reasons, but he was consistent with his practice. Depression was present. But he could see that there was something within himself that was not depressed, that was silent and vast. There's a common presumption by dedicated practitioners of the contemplative path that we think that spiritual progress is marked by lack of struggle in life. And the purpose of this segment has been to emphasize that this is simply not the case. Spiritual progress is learning to confront struggle in a new way so that we don't struggle with the fact that life is fraught with struggle. But the practice of contemplation will expose us to many things we would rather not see but need to see if we are to grow. Even something as potentially debilitating as depression. Saint Teresa of Avila was amazed to discover that in her own daily life, struggle and deep bedrock peace occurred together. She states with her customary authority, "Just because the soul sits in perpetual peace does not mean that the faculties, more surface levels of our person that are especially vulnerable to afflictive thoughts and thinking we're caught in a phone booth with a bee. She says there are always going to be wars going on in these other dwellings of the soul, there is no lack of trials and exhaustion, but these battles rarely have power anymore to unseat the soul from her place of peace. Stillness calms and soothes even such battles as depression, obsessive compulsive disorder. These too, however, can be vehicles by which the mystery we call God breaks through and shines in awareness. The last segment of this, my presentation, that silence is not about the absence of sound waves. There was a question earlier today about distractions of a audible sort. But the silence we're seeking is not about the presence or absence of sound waves. And that's the theme of this talk, this last section. You know the author Kathleen Norris, well, before she was able to earn her living on royalties, she used to teach. And part-time in art. And she recounts in her book, Amazing Grace, her remarkable way of going about teaching elementary school students how to draw. But she knew that first she needed to teach them how to be silent and aware. She explains to the class that when she raises her hand, they are to make as much noise as they possibly can. So you can imagine what these sixth graders were looking forward to. And she said there would be, and then when she dropped her hand, there would be no noise, no movement, no making funny faces. And it took a couple of practices. But then the lesson began. She raised her hand, and an almighty racket ensued. She had to keep it brief so that the principal downstairs would think he was hearing things, which is hard to make principals do. And so she dropped her hand, and the noise indeed stopped instantly. She says they were so still that silence became a presence. What fascinates her about this is that silence liberated the imagination of so many children. Her simple exercise with these school children shows us something important about the nature of silence. Silence is not simply about the absence of sound waves. It has to do with awareness and attention. Silence and awareness are, in fact, one thing. Poets seem to know about this unity of silence and awareness. Remember Wallace Stevens' series of poems, 13 Ways of Looking at a Blackbird. In section 5, he says, I do not know which to prefer, the beauty of inflections or the beauty of innuendos, the blackbird whistling or just after. Wendell Berry knows also about birdsong. He says in one of his poems, the best of any song is birdsong in the quiet. But first, you must have the quiet. Mary Oliver walking in the schoolyard of open countryside, of nature. Huh? Is likewise aware as she listens to the teachings of chaffinches, chickadees, warblers, waves and wind. They lead her out of her labors, as she says, with the mind steps of language. Thus unburdened by language, wonder and awareness expand. And she says, and then, like peace, after perfect speech, such stillness. Like Wallace Stevens, Wendell Berry, Mary Oliver is aware of this porous union of sound and silence. But are they aware of silence that isn't pleasing? That too manifests the same silence that we would prefer to hear. Without doubt, regular periods of physical silence play a crucial role in the spiritual life, and this must be cultivated, protected, reverenced. We don't make retreats along highways and places of retreat, centers of recovery and healing. Even some religious communities purposely cultivate physical silence in the service of something else. Stretches of physical silence and contemplation, especially on a daily basis, help de-stress the nervous system, this main nerve trunk, the vagus nerve trunk. While the constant stimulation of the noise of everyday life keeps anxiety levels high and our attention riveted on objects that we're more or less aware of, whether exterior objects such as a computer screen or an interior object such as a thought or what I call mind tripping, the undergraduates. But God is not an object, according to classical Christian theology. God is not an object in the way these things are objects, and therefore cannot be an object of awareness in the same way. This is, the technical term is esse indistinctum, not particular being, like this paperclip, or gravity, or black holes, or quarks. God's not just one thing added on to other particular beings. Huh? An environment of physical simplicity and silence helps relax the tight grip of our mind's reactive preoccupation with objects in order that deeper ways of encountering an ineffable mystery that gets called God, that we all have within us, may emerge, open, and receive that light that constantly gives. Is already shining out our own eyes. But not all silence is the same. As the awkward silence, the road trip with someone whom we do not know quite well enough to be silent with. And so there's a constant thinking of the next topic of conversation. Because silence and relationality work together. And if we're not, we don't know a person well enough, we feel awkward, too awkward to be silent with them. Perfectly fine to reveal everything we know about ourselves on Facebook or Facebook or whatever. There's this refrigerating silence of the cold shoulder. There's the reverential silence of dogwoods. The vast uplift of the silence of a cathedral, the focused silence of absorption in our sewing or a good book, the stunned silence of seeing the status of our pension fund. Each features physical silence, the absence of sound waves. But this silence is merely the outer form of other dynamics. In the spiritual life, silence is characterized by a powerfully sifting and subtle dynamic. Silence is real enough to be afraid of. If we know how to dwell in physical silence, then silence becomes not a threat, but attractive, nurturing, liberating. It's one thing to see the unity of silence and sound when our teachers are birdsong and the seas breaking waves. But what might Wallace Stevens, Wendell Berry, or Mary Oliver say about unpleasant noise? Can noise also be a vehicle of that peace after perfect speech? If we have a reactive be in the phone booth relationship with noise, then yes, it's going to be an obstacle. But if our own inner silence has expanded to take in the whole world, then it changes our experience of what we previously called noise and distraction. Now, our preference remains. And sometimes these preferences developed into spasms of preference. But does the sound we'd prefer not to hear have anything to reveal? Can noise, too, be a teacher pointing to the silence, capital S, that is the ground of all? You see, everything, it's the teacher in me looking for a blackboard. An ancient Syrian monk, Dennis the Areopagite, he used to be called Pseudo Dionysius, but he's the pseudo means fake, and anyway, he's been so influential they removed the pseudo And anyway, but he likens both the spiritual life and the life of the church as a chariot wheel with spokes, whatever they were called, leading into the hub, the center. On the periphery of the wheel, the spokes are furthest to get apart from one another. We ourselves are furthest from one another and experience distance from one another, shooting distance from one another, waving distance, ecumenical distance. But as each spoke moves to the hub, they're all one. Birdsong is a spoke. Your brothers in community belching are a spoke. Everything that is a spoke into the one center. My center is your center. Silence ultimately overcomes the illusion of being separate from God and of one another. And the solitary journey to the center leads to a seat of solidarity with all. Solidarity with all is another word for compassion. There was a man named Gareth making a silent retreat. He'd saved up for to go to one of these places and treat centers to keep themselves going. They're not exactly cheap. And anyway, he wanted to make this week-long retreat on contemplative prayer and thought this would be a good way to deepen his well-established contemplative practice. And the retreat center was beautifully situated in this small village on the mountainside. And it was just what he wanted, except that every afternoon for 1 hour, over three consecutive days, the neighbor next door to the retreat house would saw timber with his electric saw. Gareth thought his fillings were going to vibrate out of his back teeth. And he seriously considered either skipping that period of prayer or just going home. The retreat guide advised him just to stick with it, to use the ordeal as an experiment in cultivating interior stillness in the midst of irritating noise. He loved the delightful noise of rainfall and bird song. And apart from this hour, there was virtually complete absence of irritating noise and full of sound waves that pleased him. And to the retreat guide's amazement, Gareth decided to try to adopt a mature attitude. And he ended up discovering something important about silence. Coping with disruptive noise that we simply cannot do anything about does not so much call for praying to the patron saint of noise reduction as to be resolved as to be resolved that it's okay for noise to be there if it happens to be there. And nothing can be done about it. To get caught up in a buzzing commentary on how irritating the buzz of the noise saw was, it makes for a very noisy relationship with noise. The irritation is something the mind adds, the noisy mind, the quiet mind. Just let this be. It has a preference that it not be there, but so instead of meeting an irritating buzzsaw, we just want to let the buzzsaw be there. If nothing can be done about it. And for this to happen, two things are required. First, if our practice has been deeply established, we're in a position to learn something from silence and its generous way of allowing noise to be present when it happens to be present. To get caught up in reactive commentary on the noise will not make it go away. But will only tighten the clench of our jaws around our preference if the noise be gone. Our own generous release into our practice mirrors what silence does all the time. Silence is wide and gracious enough to allow all sound, even irritating sound, to be present. Secondly, instead of trying to push disruption away, we shift our attention away from the disruptive noise to our practice, whatever our practice happens to be. The return is not a pushing away or a reactive clinging, but a generous release into our practice. We'll soon begin to see that the noisy disruptions that we cannot control become an exercise, a training that strengthens us in our practice the way a challenging terrain strengthens a distance runner. But again, this return to our practice will not be a pushing away or a flight from the disruption. Deepening immersion into our practice is simultaneous with the disruption, with allowing disruption to be present. We just become better about it, not letting it steal our attention. And this is what Gareth learned. He preferred to have no disturbance. But through a gift of insight, he saw that the silence was actually receiving the sound of the saw, was simply the sound of the saw. The sense of irritation was supplied by his mental commentary on the noise. And then he said something happened. And he said, it's very difficult to put words on this, but my commenting mind simply fell away. There was only the sound of the saw, but there was no commenting mind listening. It was only the sound of the saw. And now that this is in the past, he says, I reflect upon it, and it sounds silly, but I know that when the mind is still, sound is as silent as no sound. have a breakthrough like this and integrated into your life, there will emerge an ethical change in your life. Groups of people whom you used to disdain for being the wrong political party, the wrong sexual orientation, the wrong color of skin, that all drops because of your experience of the center of the wheel. One of the most ancient definitions of God, which by definition can't be defined, is that God is that sphere whose center is everywhere and whose circumference is nowhere. So indeed, silence has more to do, does more than just tiptoe around the house. Now, not everybody had the same breakthrough as Gareth. On the second to the last day of the retreat, as soon as the neighbor's table saw began its daily squeal, one man got up from his place in the meditation room, stormed out of the retreat center, and rampaged over to the neighbor's garage. He then yanked the saw's electric cord out of its socket, overturned the neighbor's table saw, and shouted at a volume all could hear, "What in the name of God do you think you're doing? Sawing wood when all these people have paid good money to have a week's peace and quiet." There was a brief interchange between the two men. A level of language was not especially elevated. But the saw ceased its daily hour of buzzing squeal. And for what was left of the retreat, the only sound was birdsong, the mooing of distant cattle, rainfall, and the sound of a gentle breeze. We can make our way on the pathless path of contemplation along different trails, each trail thick with tangled vines of providence. As I said, life has a way of being exactly the way it happens to be at any given moment. Life being how it is, just this, is a wheel of spokes leading into the hub of silence that embraces all, irrespective of the presence or absence of pleasant or unpleasant sound. Discovering the silence that resounds in all sound, even in noise, whether we are in country quiet or market mayhem, this strengthens our practice of contemplation and leads to a new ethic of silence. The end. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
Your applause tells me that you indeed join me in thanking Father Martin Laird for the perfect speech. And as